It's one of our greatest fears. Being on a plane when something goes badly wrong. This series reveals what it's like to live through catastrophic events on board an aircraft.
I just had visions of being burnt alive on this plane.
Using footage that captured these terrifying moments. And hearing from those who survived them.
Everyone looked tense in their seats. It felt like this could be their final moments of their lives.
I looked out to see some of the engine flying off.
At that point, I planned to meet my maker.
These are the world's worst flights.
All right, we're gonna land field right here.
Every day, around the world, over 11 million passengers take to the air. 99.99% of them will never be on board a plane that suffers a mechanical failure. But for the few that do, it can be terrifying. Coming up in this program, an engine fire engulfs the side of an aircraft.
You just imagine a plane's gonna turn into a massive fireball any second.
A roof is blown open at 34,000 feet.
All I had to do was just look up and I could see blue sky.
And a power failure forces a crash landing in shark-infested waters.
I expected something pretty violent. I half expected to die.
September 2015. Ellie and Paul Waldridge had traveled from London for a two-week holiday to celebrate their 50th birthdays.
Done loads of things, went in all the hotels, all the roller coaster rides, done the Grand Canyon.
We was there 10 days. There's just so much to see, do, and want much more than that from your 50th birthday. It's fantastic.
On the 8th of September, Ellie and Paul's dream holiday came to an end. They headed back to Vegas's bustling McCarran Airport for their journey home.
We left about 2 in the afternoon. Just a normal, beautiful, red hot sunny day.
You sort of know you're going to be on a long flight again, and you get a bit, just want to get home now.
CCTV from that afternoon showed the airport working normally. It was a sunny, warm, 38-degree day with light cloud cover. Perfect conditions for flying. At 3:30 p.m., Ellie, Paul, and 155 other passengers boarded their plane.
Just got on. As you do, you put your stuff in the overhead locker, just sit down, and that's it. You just sort of settle in, waiting for your flight.
Over 21,000 gallons of jet fuel filled the plane's 3 fuel tanks, ready for the journey back to England. Ellie and Paul would be traveling 5,200 miles to London's Heathrow Airport. The flight was due to take just over 10 hours, arriving in the UK at 11 a.m. the following morning. Making final preparations for the flight was veteran British Airways pilot Captain Chris Henke.
It was my penultimate flight. I had one more flight to Barbados, and then I was due to retire.
Air traffic control made contact with Chris's plane, which had the call sign Speedbird 2276 Heavy.
Speedbird 2276 Heavy, Las Vegas Tower.
2276 Heavy, good afternoon. We're ready for departure, Alfred.
3:55 p.m. The plane began its 3-kilometer journey from the airport terminal to the start of the runway.
When we started taxiing, I was near the window. So I'm just sort of looking out, just last look before we leave, really.
At 4:11 p.m., Chris's plane was given clearance for takeoff.
Speedbird 2276 Heavy, wind 360 at 5, runway 7 left at Alpha 8, cleared for takeoff.
7 takeoff, 07 left, Speedbird 2276 Heavy.
As the plane began to accelerate, one of the passengers decided to film the takeoff.
started airing down the runway, and I thought we was getting really close to takeoff, but literally just waiting for the plane to tilt back a little bit. There was a large bang, and the plane list sort of pulled to the left.
As soon as you hear that bang and you think, what is that? You know something's wrong straight away, but you don't know what it is.
The passenger's video had caught the plane going over what seemed like a small bump. Up in the cockpit, the sound had also been heard by Captain Chris Henke.
It's almost like a dull thud, really. Initial thought that it could have been a tire blowing.
And then the plane sort of stopped. And everyone started undoing all the seatbelts. It was like click, click, click. Everyone was standing up.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain seated. Please remain seated.
And the stewardess, she started saying, sit down, sit down. It's only a puncher. I looked out the window. I said to the wife, I said, that's no puncher. We're getting off.
Passengers in the cabin could see smoke and flames seconds after the plane stopped on the runway.
All I kept thinking is, this is going to explode. It's on fire. Them wings are full up with fuel. I just had visions of being burnt alive on this plane.
Airport CCTV captured a potential catastrophe. Ellie and Paul's plane was filled with thousands of gallons of jet fuel and ablaze with fire.
And I kept thinking, I'm not going to get off this. I'm not going to get off.
of September 2015, 4:13 p.m. CCTV at Las Vegas's McCarran Airport captured the precise moment a peaceful day was shattered. British Airways flight 2276 to London was about to take off when it had suffered a major mechanical failure, bursting into flames. Air traffic control immediately grounded all aircraft.
Right on ground, hold position.
Other pilots in nearby planes witnessed the incident unfolding. Ellie and Paul Wooldridge were two of the 157 passengers trapped on board this burning aircraft.
All I knew was that fire was in the engine that was on the wing that was full up with fuel. And that's all I knew, is that that'll explode.
You just imagine the plane's going to turn into a massive fireball any second. And it was scary.
In the cockpit, Captain Chris Henke was unaware how serious the fire was.
The thing was that we couldn't see anything. There was just this grey shadow behind us.
All Chris had to go on was a fire alarm, alerting him to an engine fire. So he tried to extinguish it.
You've got two fire handles. It'll be lit up red for whichever engine is on fire, and you pull that and then you twist it.
Fire extinguishers for aircraft engines are only effective if the fire is contained inside the engine structure. This explosion had destroyed the engine casing, so when Chris deployed the fire extinguishers, they had no effect. And the fire was getting worse.
If you are facing a massive fuel leak because you've got a hole in your fuel tank, in your wing, and you've got the flames there already from a hot engine, that can deteriorate really rapidly, and we can actually end up in an explosive situation.
27 seconds after the fire broke out, Chris radioed air traffic control, who had already alerted the emergency services.
Speedbird, mayday, mayday, Speedbird 2276, request fire services.
Speedbird 2276, heavy fire services are on the way.
It's like you're in a bubble. I mean, everything's going on around you, but it's all sort of slow motion.
Passengers could see the fire spreading. Leaking fuel was now burning on the runway.
We could hear people screaming and shouting. So I asked the other first officer to go down the back, just to assess the situation.
one of the pilots, he ran down, he looked out the window, and then he ran back.
I looked at him, I said, is it bad? He said, yes. I said, how bad? He said, very bad.
I start to panic, like, I want to get off, I want to get off. But because, like, you're still on it and all the doors are shut, and I kept thinking, I'm not going to get off this. I'm not going to get off.
Large airports have emergency services on standby in the event of a major mechanical failure. Pilots who face serious problems when airborne don't have the benefit of this type of help. Lying in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, Hawaii is made up of 137 islands and relies on light aircraft to ferry tourists and locals between them. Although incredibly popular, these small planes have no major backup systems. If they suffer a mechanical failure, it's all down to the pilot to land the plane safely.
You are flying on the basis of, I've only got one engine, this engine might quit at any time for whatever reason, so I need to be able to do a successful forced landing.
On the 11th of December 2013, Marilyn Briley and her husband Bruce were at the desolate Kalaupapa Airport, waiting for one of these planes.
There's not much of an airport there. It's like an open-air warehouse.
A very, very tiny airport. It seated perhaps a dozen people. There was a water cooler. There was a washroom, and that was it.
Just after 3 p.m., Bruce and Marilyn boarded their plane with six other passengers, ready to make the short 54-mile flight from Molokai back to Honolulu International Airport. At 3:15 p.m., the plane taxied to the airport's only runway. One of the passengers switched on his camera to record the plane's picturesque takeoff.
The plane was a turboprop, a Cessna. It was two seats across. Okay, my wife and I were the ones most forward. So we were sitting just behind the pilot.
After 20 years of flying between Hawaii's islands, pilot Clyde Kawasaki knew the dangers of Kalaupapa's airport.
It's not an airport for a first timer. You're not talking with air traffic control out there. Basically, it's uncontrolled airspace. Because you're in a bowl, you don't even have cell phone coverage. Got to the end of the runway, then brought the power up, brakes released, off you went down the runway. Normal takeoff.
We're climbing into the air, and my wife and I, out of habit, hold hands until we're at the altitude.
Once the plane reached 500 feet, passenger recording the takeoff turned off his camera.
I don't know that I've ever heard anything louder than that. It was like an explosion.
It blew up. Basically, it blew up.
Seconds after an explosion in the engine, the passenger turned his camera back on and captured what happened in the cabin.
Silence, dead silence.
The audible for the fire warning, it was going off. I had no engine. We're too low and too far out to make land, so prepare for a water landing. I gotta keep my airspeed, basically head into the wind and hope for the best. There's no way you can train for that.
For a little while, you can't believe it. Okay, this isn't really happening. I expected something pretty violent. I half expected to die. The actual impact was such that I could only compare it with being hit with a baseball bat.
When we hit, I went headfirst into the panel and I put my hand up and blood. First thing I thought was sharks, because that's shark-infested waters.
In the aftermath of the crash, the passenger continued to film the rush to escape the plane.
You know, we just had to hurry up and get out of there. And if it wasn't for Bruce, I probably wouldn't have gotten out of there because he helped me out.
Shoulder and yelled for everybody to get the hell out of the airplane, and when I looked back, everybody was already out. Nobody checked on me.
In the rush to escape, Marilyn had left without a life jacket. Now she was struggling to keep her head above water.
When I got out, I went and swam and held on to the wing of the plane. When the captain got out, he saw I didn't have a life vest, so he gave me a life vest, and he didn't have a life vest either.
First thing to do is try to keep everybody together. It's easier to find a group than it is to find individuals. And I was just getting ready to tie off everybody to each other. And a wave came over and that was it. It scattered everybody. It scattered everybody. It's like, oh geez. Now what are we gonna do?
In an instant, everybody disappeared. Everybody went with the waves and the current. Everybody was gone. And I was in the ocean all by myself.
We were together, and then, like that, suddenly I found myself alone. Where's Marilyn? Where are the other people? Where's the plane?
Large modern aircraft are mechanical marvels with over 3 million working parts. Strict maintenance schedules and numerous backups for critical systems mean mechanical failures are extremely rare. But when they happen, their impact can be devastating. 18th of September 2014, 9:30 a.m. JetBlue Flight 1416 had just taken off from California's Long Beach Airport. This was scheduled to be a three-hour flight to Austin, Texas. Jared West, one of its 142 passengers, had been on edge since the plane left the ground.
As soon as we began to take off, the plane seemed louder than usual. And that seemed odd to me, but it wasn't alarming. And as we climbed out, it continued to be loud.
Air traffic control guided Jared's plane up over Southern California as planned.
JetBlue 1416, good morning. Turn left, heading 130, climb and maintain 10,000.
Left heading 130, climb to 10,000, JetBlue 1416.
At about 8 to 10,000 foot level, there was a loud boom. It was really loud. Everybody on board heard it, whether they were wearing headphones or not, and everybody let out a gasp or a yell.
One passenger grabbed his phone and captured the immediate aftermath.
I was way in the front of the fuselage, so I looked back to see, because everybody was screaming at this point, so I'm looking back to see what was going on, and sure enough, it was black smoke. You couldn't see to the back of the plane anymore. And that's when I realized that it was a really serious situation.
12 rows back from Jarrett, in row 13, was Victoria Rivett.
You imagine the worst when you see smoke. You basically think, if there's smoke, there's a fire somewhere. I hope to God it's not in the engine. I hope to God that we could land safely, that we're not just gonna go down in flames.
Most passengers don't realize that oxygen on their aircraft comes directly from the engines. So this thick smoke meant there must have been a serious engine failure. Oxygen masks had dropped down so people could breathe fresh air. But in row 13, Victoria had a problem.
Everyone has masks except for me and my row, the other two passengers. They're lucky they have masks. Must be nice. ours would not deploy at all. They were jammed. So the airline stewardess said she would come back to us, and we were just looking around wondering how long do we have to wait, because we were having a hard time breathing here. She did end up coming back, and she physically had to unjam it.
Everybody on the plane was fearful for their lives. Many people were praying, and many people were holding hands with one another.
I am not a religious person, and I wish at that moment in time I believed in God. I remember thinking that would be great right now.
I remember at one point the lady that was sitting directly behind me, she reached forward and she touched my shoulder, and I grabbed her hand this way, and the human contact at that point, when I wasn't sure about my future and wasn't sure about the fate of the airplane at that point, it was a very reassuring thing. You know.
With smoke filling the cabin, flight attendants insisted passengers keep their masks on.
The thoughts that ran through my mind were just, you know, what I have so much to say to some of my loved ones. What? How do I say this? How do I get my words out before it's the end? So I took my phone out and I videotaped myself saying goodbye to my mother, telling her that I loved her. If I was gonna have to go early, then I just wanted her to know that she was the most valuable person to me in my life. I was talking during this video, but you can't hear me because the oxygen mask is over my face. And it was so loud inside the plane, and there were so many alarms going off and everything. But you could see the fear in my eyes. And I remember saying in the video, if someone finds this, because I figured that there would be wreckage and that the phone might be found. And if it was, then please give the message to my mom. That was a very scary thing.
The pilot radioed air traffic control for help.
JetBlue 1416, SoCal approach.
JetBlue 1416, we're declaring an emergency, sir. We've got a number 2 engine fire.
4 minutes after smoke filled the cabin, the pilot made an announcement to the passengers.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've had a right engine failure. I'm shutting down the engine. We're headed back to Long Beach at this time. Please stay in your seats and we'll try and clear the cabin as well as we can. Thank you.
The engine fire had forced the pilot to shut it down, leaving the plane with just one working engine. At 9:41 a.m., with smoke still in the cabin, flight attendants prepared passengers for an emergency landing at Long Beach Airport.
All the flight attendants were very frightened. And if they're nervous, then we're nervous.
Everyone looked tense in their seats, kind of bracing themselves. You know, just their felt like this could be their final moments of their lives.
Nobody was sure whether we had all of our landing gear. You know, none of us were sure if we were going to actually land.
Total relief when we landed. We couldn't believe we made it alive out of that plane, and to feel the ground beneath your feet after experience like that is just the best feeling.
A detailed examination of the engine revealed the cause of the fire. A piece of metal the size of a thumb that held the engine blades had shattered. Metal shards had ripped through the engine. Five dents on the outside of the plane showed where these shards had come close to piercing the cabin and injuring passengers. In this incident, the pilot had been able to get the fire under control. But not all pilots are so lucky. September 8th, 2015, 4:14 p.m. Airport CCTV captured a British Airways plane bound for London with an engine fire burning out of control. 170 people, including Ellie Wooldridge and her husband Paul, were trapped inside the plane.
It was just like a dream. I kept thinking, I'm going to wake up in a minute. This ain't happening.
Speedbird, mayday, mayday. Speedbird 2276, request fire services.
Speedbird 2276, heavy fire services are on the way.
91 seconds after the first sign of smoke, Captain Chris Henke ordered an evacuation.
All of a sudden you get emergency evacuation, and then you just see like all these stewardesses, they run to their exits.
All 157 passengers prepared to evacuate.
Me and the wife, we were literally at the door at the same time as the steward. He opened the door and we was watching the thing fall down. He said, wait, wait, wait.
And I'm thinking, I just want to get off, I don't want to get off.
Only three of the eight emergency slides could be used.
And then as soon as the chute comes down, he said, right, you can go. I was down. I didn't even wait for Paul. I was gone, and then Paul comes straight down behind me, and he's just looked that way, and then he went, they all just run. He said, that's going to blow, just run.
21,000 gallons of fuel were held in the three tanks near the fire.
I looked to the right, and it was just a massive ball of fire. And we was literally running for our lives across the runway.
Once safely away from the raging fire, Ellie started filming on her mobile phone.
You turn around and you just stand there looking at it. The middle of the plane you couldn't see because of the fire and the smoke. It was just unbelievable, and you're just standing there watching it and you think, I've just got off that.
As captain, Chris was not leaving the plane until all his passengers had been safely evacuated. Then air traffic control were told the remaining crew would be leaving the plane.
Speedbird 2276 heavy.
Speedbird 2276 heavy, go ahead.
Speedbird 2276 heavy, we are evacuating on the runway. We have a fire, I repeat, we are evacuating.
Speedbird 2276 heavy, roger.
The cabin manager came and said, Captain, everybody's off. I was thinking of going down to check myself, but there's smoke everywhere. I thought it would be a bit dangerous to do. So the three of the flight deck, we went down the slide and then sort of started herding the passengers together.
What was meant to have been his penultimate flight would now signal the end of Chris's 42-year flying career.
Oh, a bit sad in a way. Lots of emotions because I knew that was it for me flying-wise. I was just pleased that everybody was fine.
Chris's quick reactions on the runway, bringing the plane to a safe stop, trying to extinguish the fire, and the crew carrying out a swift evacuation resulted in no serious injuries. So when Chris met with the passengers, he was given a hero's welcome.
Everyone just gave him a round of applause. Yeah, and we was just all pleased for it all to be over.
He did look really pale and shaken, but he was good, he explained everything, what had happened.
Well, we did our job, basically. And, all the crew, two co-pilots and all the 10 cabin crew, we all did a great job.
Ellie and Paul had escaped physical injury, but the memory of this flight still left a scar. 24 hours later, the airline booked them onto another plane home.
Coming home, that was really, really traumatic. My wife, she was in a real mess, and I literally had to force her onto the plane.
it's not easy to get it out of your head. I didn't want to get on a plane again. I wanted to get on a boat. Can you put me on a boat?
Images taken by an investigation team revealed the damage suffered by the aircraft. The cause of the fire was discovered to be a circular metal spool deep in the heart of the engine. During takeoff, it had fractured and torn through the structure around it. The images also showed how close the resulting fire had come to reaching the inside of the cabin. Everyone on board had had a lucky escape. Last year, there were 39 million flights worldwide, twice as many as 20 years ago. The demands airlines put on their aircraft are higher than ever.
There are some airlines that specialize in short hop flights, that is, flights of an hour or two or less, and they're using that airplane several times a day.
Frequent use means more passengers are witnessing rare structural failures on their aircraft. During extreme turbulence on a flight to India's capital, Delhi, an interior window broke loose. Flight crew rushed to get it back in place before passengers were put in danger. And over London, one passenger captured the moment the wing of their plane started falling apart. Although shocking, these failures didn't cause any serious injuries to those on board. Other failures, however, can be much more dangerous. On the 1st of April 2011, Southwest Flight 812, making a two-hour flight between the American cities of Phoenix and Sacramento, was involved in a mid-air emergency. Greg Hansen was one of the 117 passengers on board.
I was reading the paper and I heard a loud popping sound, sort of metal related. Like a tin can being crushed. I looked around, nobody else had a look of alarm on their face or anything of that nature. So I just went back to reading the paper. Probably just about a minute after I heard those first two sounds, then that's when it really happened. It's just like a lid opening on a can.
At 34,000 feet, the roof of the plane had been torn open. Greg's footage captured the 5-foot hole that had suddenly appeared above the cabin.
All I had to do was just look back and up, and I could see blue sky.
Oxygen was rushing out. Greg and the other passengers were in a situation that could turn deadly in seconds. First of April, 2011. At 34,000 feet, Southwest Flight 812 from Phoenix, Arizona, carrying 117 passengers, was facing a critical emergency. Its roof had been ripped open. Oxygen was rushing out of the cabin. If action wasn't taken quickly, everyone on board would suffocate and die. Passenger Greg Hansen captured the shocking images of the 5-foot hole that had suddenly appeared above him.
The situation at that point would not feel real. Don't expect that you'll be cruising at 34,000 feet and that the plane will open up on you. The one thing that strikes me is just the sunlight, how the sunlight's pouring through a fuselage, and that's the last thing you'd ever expect.
At 34,000 feet, there's 73% less available oxygen than at sea level. Every passenger on board was in imminent danger of passing out and then death.
At that altitude, the time of useful consciousness is well under 30 seconds.
Within seconds of the hole appearing, the pilots declared an emergency and oxygen masks dropped down.
Southeast 12, we've got a hole in the fuselage in the back of the airplane.
The pilot needed to quickly put the plane into a dive so they could reach lower altitude and breathable air. Air traffic control rushed to get approval for the dive.
This is Sector 60, Southwest 812 is an emergency decompression descent. He'd like 10,000 feet. Can you approve that?
I'm
doing it anyway.
Yes.
Southwest 812, descend and maintain 10,000.
At 1601,
the pilot put the plane into a sharp dive, dropping 89 feet per second.
The pilot took that rapid descent. Definitely, that was the white knuckle part. I've never experienced that type of G-force before.
After reaching 9,000 feet, the pilot radioed for the nearest airport.
How far away is Yuma from us right now?
Yuma is at 50 miles.
We'll take Yuma.
Roger, you are clear to the Yuma Airport. Maintain 9,000.
30 minutes after Greg had witnessed the roof torn open, his plane safely touched down. Greg captured the relief in the cabin.
They're on YouTube now.
Once we landed, everybody's crowding around taking pictures and everybody's happy to be alive and definitely talking about it.
The subsequent investigation discovered something that Southwest's maintenance might never have spotted. A row of 8mm rivets along one roof panel had suffered metal fatigue. Greg's plane had completed 39,781 flights, an average of 7 flights every day for 15 years. And every flight had put these rivets under pressure, until finally they couldn't take any more. An incident in 1988 showed how serious this event could have been. Flying at 24,000 feet, this Aloha flight had the entire front roof of the plane ripped off, with catastrophic consequences.
One of the flight attendants was ejected out into the ocean, was never found again.
This incident showed how deadly metal fatigue can be for passengers on an aircraft. This invisible threat can only be spotted with improved and regular maintenance. The heroic pilot of this Aloha flight had managed to navigate back to a nearby airport. But landing back on a runway is not always possible. 8th of December, 2015, 3:23 p.m. A light aircraft traveling en route to Honolulu had suffered a major mechanical failure. An explosion on board cut all power in the plane. 32 seconds later, it crashed into shark-infested waters with no mayday call possible. Pilot Clyde Kawasaki had suffered cuts to his face in the crash and had no life jacket. He swam over to a nearby passenger who had a flotation device.
And the first thing he said was, "You're bleeding." I go, "Yeah, I know." And that's when we came, we didn't have to say it. We came to the agreement that shark shows up, I have to leave them because they're not coming after them, they're coming after me. Fact of life, you know. My first job is the safety of my passengers, and if I'm drawing attention to my passengers, it can't be that way. I'd have to leave, draw them away.
Passengers Bruce Briley and his wife Marilyn had been separated from everyone, including each other. After over an hour in the water, they were starting to lose hope of rescue.
There were no airplanes coming over. There were no boats around. Every time I turned around to look at the island, it was farther away and the salt water would hit me in the face.
We had been told that that was an area that was particularly rich in sharks. And, you know, at any moment, one could be taken. And flitting through my mind was, do I want that? Would it be better just duck my head under and breathe in?
was starting to get dark and cold. And I started thinking of my kids and my grandkids and wondering if I'd ever see them again. And I stopped treading water and decided that that was it. I wasn't going to survive.
By now, the passengers had been in the water for 80 minutes. As nighttime was approaching, help finally arrived. A plane had spotted the crash site earlier and called in helicopter rescue.
All of a sudden I heard somebody say, "I'm gonna get you out of here." I turned around and I saw this guy and I said, "Oh my God," it was like an angel came from heaven.
And the rescue swimmer came over. "How you feeling?" "Great now."
But not everyone had survived. While in the water, a female passenger had suffered a fatal heart attack. In a rescue helicopter, her body was laid down next to Bruce.
When I put my hands on her face to clear the hair, her face was warm. Well, I was cold, okay? I was cold. And so I suspect that she died in my arms.
Rescued by different helicopters, Bruce and Marilyn had no idea if the other had survived. They were flown separately from the crash site to a nearby hospital.
I kept asking about my wife and there was no information. Or maybe an hour and a half went by and then all of a sudden she was there. And they pulled her up beside me. Oh my God, what a good feeling.
Oh my God, it was like heaven seeing them. You know, that he survived and I survived. Picked up my hand and we held our hand for a while.
For the survivors of the crash, the memory of this flight will stay with them forever.
It's an indelible thing on your life, you know? And I identified all of them as heroes, our heroes. You know, the big one was Kawasaki. You know, had some kind of amateur been flying the plane, we'd be dead. I mean, he's, in our book, he's tops.
I don't know. Mixed emotions. I just did what I'm supposed to do and what was expected of me.
Clyde continued to fly passengers for another 3 years before retiring in 2018. For Bruce and Marilyn, this flight had a profound impact on their lives.
We have not been in an airplane since, and I don't know if I will ever fly again.
They often say such a thing is life-changing, and it is. It is. Things that were important to you before become less so. And you begin to really enjoy life more. I mean, just the fact of being alive is a wonderful thing.
Next time on World's Worst Flights. An engine bursts into flames mid-flight.
Just get back down on that runway as fast as you can.
A landing goes horribly wrong. And a plane heads towards the ground with no landing gear.
I texted my wife, you know, kind of saying goodbye.